Today we're going to take a look at a game called Antike Duellum, which is a two-player strategy game with area control, resource generation, and resource management. The primary mechanic that happens in this game, though, is a rondel, or rondel, for choosing your actions. So it's going to involve a lot of pre-planning and deciding how you're going to move your piece around that action wheel, trying to take the actions that will allow you to build new settlements and conquer your opponent's settlements so that you can come out on top. Okay, so here we've got the board for Antike Duellum. There's this side, which is the Persian Wars, and then the opposite side of the board is the Punic Wars. The geography changes, that's the only difference. On the board, you have a whole bunch of different settlements, which will be places where you're going to put down these little settlement tokens during the game when you conquer them. At the start of the game, you'll notice that there are six cities that are differently marked on the board, and those are going to be your starting settlements. So one player marks them, and each player has one in gold, marble, and iron. So you just match up your three with the three that are on the board, and you are all set. We also have a score track where each player is going to put a marker. And on the score track, you'll notice that as you go up, you have these little markers here, these kind of square things at some levels. And that's just to show you that when you reach those levels of points, you get one of these defense tokens that you can build, and we'll talk about how that works later. So each player is going to start with one of those since there's one at zero. We have a stack of cards and three start out visible. Whenever a player gains a point in this game, the other player gets to take one of these cards. It's kind of a balancing mechanic so that if one player is making a lot of points, the other player is getting a lot of cards that they can use as special actions during the game to hopefully balance things out and catch up. We also have this row of cards. These are point scoring cards. So we have them for doing different things like building cities, doing research, destroying temples, building temples, and then doing naval exploration by having a lot of ships out on the board. So you have different routes that you can go to get these victory points during the game. Each player has a recruitment box that is their location where, during the game, when they recruit a unit, it'll first appear in this box. You pay the cost for the unit that's shown. So one gold for infantry and then two gold for galleys. And then you'll have to pay iron to outfit those troops to bring them out of the box and place them at one of your settlements. We'll talk about how that works in actions. But each player begins with one of each unit in their box. On the board, we also have our research track. This just shows you what the different researches are and what their cost is. The first number, the higher of the two numbers, is the cost for the first player to conduct that research. And then the second player pays less. But the first player gets to take one of these scholar cards for doing research, and the second player doesn't. So getting research first gives you the advantage of the research and also gives you victory points. Research doesn't need to be conducted in any order on this track, so you can research the highest one if you want first or something in the middle, whatever you want to do. You don't have to start at one end and work your way across. Each player is going to start with three of each resource, so three gold, three marble, and then 3 iron for each player. And whoever the second player is also going to start with one of these coins. Coins are just a wild resource, so you can use it to satisfy any of these during the game. Okay, so the last part of the board is the rondel, or the rondel. Each player has 1 action token. And at the start of the game, you're going to decide where your piece begins in which one of these actions. After the first turn, though, so say you choose Aurum here. After the first turn, you can only move clockwise around this circle. And you only get to move up to 3 spaces for free. If you want to move a 4th space, you have to spend 1 resource. So any one of your iron, gold, or marble tokens will let you move a 4th, a 5th for 2, a 6th for 3, or you can move all the way back around if you want to spend 5 resources to do so. It gives you a fair amount of flexibility in how you do these actions. So let's talk about what these actions are. We'll start with Aurum. Aurum, Marmor, and Ferum are each your gathering resources. Whenever you go to one of these 3 actions, you will count the number of cities that you have on the board, and if you are taking the gold action, Aurum, you'll count your number of gold cities and get 1 gold token for each city. Or count your number of marble-producing cities and get 1 for each marble city. Or count your number of iron resource cities. So whenever you're gathering resources, you'll count your number of cities that produce that resource and take that number of that resource. You also get 1 coin, one of those wild resource tokens, every time you take a resource action. The Templum action is your ability to build. So if you take this, you can either build a temple. So you'll build a temple in one of your cities for a cost of 6 marble plus 1 coin, so one of your wild resources, if you have them, for each adjacent temple. So if you're placing this second one, it's going to cost you 6 marble plus 1 coin because of this other temple that you have. Or, for a cost of 1 marble, you can build one of these defensive wall markers that increase the defense of your city by 1. You can do any combination of those actions as long as you can afford to do it. So if you have the resources to build 2 or 3 temples and build all of the defensive walls that you have in your supply, you can spend all of the marble to do that. As long as you have the resources to pay for it and you have the walls in your personal supply, you can do so. So temples are a limited supply. So if this supply is exhausted, you can't build any more temples. Temples just make your cities more efficient. If a city has a temple, instead of producing 1 gold, the city is going to produce 3 gold. Instead of having a defense of 1, the city now has a defense of 3. Instead of only being able to place 1 troop at this city when you muster troops, you can place up to 3 troops out of your box at this city if it has a temple each turn. Walls just increase the defense of the city by 1. So if you have a wall and a temple, the defense of the city is 4. The Scientia action, the science action, allows you to conduct research down here on the know-how track. So you can pay the indicated amount of gold to research any of these special abilities. Increasing the movement of your infantry so they move 2 spaces instead of 1. That's what these 2 arrows indicate. And then the same thing, increasing the movement of your ships to 2 instead of 1. every time you collect resources, gaining one additional resource of that type, increasing the defense of all of your cities by one, and then the ability to cash in resources, trading three resource tokens of any type for two resource tokens of any type. Except you can't get coins in this way, obviously. The other thing you can do with the science action is purchase troops. So you can pay gold out of your supply, or coins if you have coins, since they are interchangeable. Paying the cost that's indicated on the board. So one for infantry or two for ships. So I could spend three gold to add a ship and an infantry unit to my box. The militia action lets me take these units out of the box and put them at one of my cities at a cost of two iron for each unit. So when you take the militia action, you can place one unit at any settlement. You can't place one infantry and one ship. You can only place one unit at each one. So you might do something like this and place one unit at one and one at another. This isn't a limitation on the number of units in the space. So later when we're moving units, you can have as many units in this one space as you want. You could have, you know, all of your ships there and you'd be fine. That's not a limitation in the game. And remember, if you place a temple in this settlement, you can place three units from your box into that square each turn. So at the start of the game, I only have three iron, so I could only place one of these units. So I might place an infantry unit so that I can start moving it, which is what the Duellum action is for. And Duellum is on the board twice. So this is probably going to be a big part of your game, moving your units around. If you take the Duellum action, you can move all of your units on the board one space, unless you have the research completed to move them a second space for that type of unit. So you might start the game and then move this unit down so that you can found a new settlement. One of the other things that's going to happen during the game is conquering settlements. So if we take the Duellum action and we move, say, a galley and a legion into this space, we're going to compare the strength of our attacking force, which is the number of units, to the defense of the city. In this case, it's just one because it's a basic city. If we had research, the Res Publica increases the defense, or if there was a temple or walls, those all increase the defense. Or if there are opposing units, we'd have to fight them first. But in this case, the defense is one. So we'd subtract one unit from the board, and we could choose whether it was going to be the galley or the legion. The city is then conquered. On a later turn, we might take Duellum again and move this galley down and attack this settlement. So the same thing happens. We have a defense of one and an offense of one. So we'd subtract one unit. And these units, when they're conquered, come back to your recruitment box over here, not off the board. So you'll be able to bring them back out by paying iron again later. So we subtract our one for the defense, and then the city would be conquered. We don't have to have units still in the space to conquer it. So if we move this galley into this region, and the opponent has a legion that is also here, the legions and the galleys don't fight each other, so we don't have a battle. You would then move on to the conquest phase and be able to decide whether or not you're going to try to conquer the city. In this case, the city's defense will be two because it has a defender. So you wouldn't want to try to conquer it because your galley would just be destroyed. If you have two galleys, though, you could go ahead and conquer, and this legion would be returned, the city would be conquered, and both of your galleys would return to your box over here. More likely, you will encounter enemy units that increase the defense. So in this case, it would be 3 against 3. So I'd lose my 3, he'd lose his 2, and the city would be conquered because we equaled the defense of the city. If any of your cities are conquered, then you get to take one of these cards. These cards that act as a balancing mechanic that will give you some kind of a special action. If 2 of your cities have been conquered, you still only get to take one card. It's just if any cities have been conquered during your opponent's turn. After every action you take, you have the option to found cities for any place where you have a unit that's next to a settlement that hasn't been claimed already. So in this case, I have a unit that's next to this settlement. I could choose to place one of these 3 types of settlements here. If I want to increase my production of gold, marble, or iron. This will cost me 1 of each resource. So 1 marble, 1 iron, and 1 gold. Plus, I have to pay an additional coin for each adjacent city that matches the resource that's being produced. If I place the gold city here, I'm fine. I just have to pay these 3 resources. But if I wanted to produce more marble or more iron, I have an iron city here, and I have a marble city here. So in that case, I'd have to pay 1 of my wild resources as an additional cost to found this city. So I'd probably go with gold early on in the game so that I'm not having to pay that coin cost. Unless I have the resources and want to do that. This is the case for both your cities and your opponent's cities. So if Brown has a marble city that's adjacent here, for this I'd have to pay 1 of each resource plus 2 coins because there are 2 cities that produce marble here. So the last part of your turn is winning any of these personage cards that are over here to the side. So you'd take a look and see if you qualify for any of these. So if you've conducted research this turn and you're the first person to conduct that research, you'd get one of these scholar cards. 5 cities on the board will get you one of these king cards. Destroying one of your enemy's temples on your turn will get you one of these cards. Having 3 temples in your territory will get you one of these cards. So for your first one, you know, 3 temples, you'd get 1. And then the next time you have 3 more temples, so when you have 6, you could claim another one. And then Navigator requires you to have 7 ships on the board. This is just a little bit complicated because you'll see that you have these spaces on the board that have a ship marker on them. If your ship is in that location, it counts as 2 ships for these navigators. So there I've got 4 ships on the board, 6 ships, and here's a 7th. So I get one of these cards for having 7 ships on the board at that point. So as soon as you claim one of these personage cards, your token goes up in victory points. And as we talked about really quickly when we were looking at this, you go up, and if it's a spot that indicates that you get one of these defensive markers, you'll get a new defensive marker from the supply to add to your personal supply. And your opponent gets to choose one of these special action cards. And these do a whole variety of things. Some of them let you produce extra resources or destroy opponents' armies. There's just a whole bunch of different actions that you can get. So when Your opponent gets a victory point. You get to look at the three cards that are available and take one of them. And then the next card will come out to fill that space. With the exception of, I think, only one card, the Fortress card, which is here. These can only be played on your turn as special actions. The game ends when one player has reached 9 points. There's one variant that's in the rulebook that has you use these tokens. The white player gets this Admiral, and the brown player gets this Commander token. Each of them is double-sided and has the opposite token on the back for whatever reason. These are special units. They cost 3 iron instead of the normal 2 iron to bring them into play. They start in your recruitment box at the beginning of the game. But otherwise, they basically act the same as your normal units. The only difference is that when units are being eliminated in a battle, they can only be removed by the same type of unit, and they're the last unit that's removed from your army. They operate just slightly differently. If your special commander or admiral unit is involved in attacking a city, you subtract 1 from the defense of that city. And if he's defending a city, then you add 1 to the defense. I'm gonna start by taking the marble action. So I'll get a marble. And I will get 1 coin. And that's it for me.
I'm just gonna chew really loudly over by the microphone here.
Why did I have... I don't know why I had a coin in my resource pile. It's probably for my example still.
Because you're a cheater. What? How much should we have?
You should have 3 of each. Okay. And then you should have 1 coin.
Okay. Slightly different sizes?
Yes. Okay. The 2 is slightly larger. I don't know if the 5 is slightly larger than the 2. I think it is. Yeah, it is.
Great. I'm also going to take the marble action.
Okay. Are we going to do the exact same thing every turn? Is that your plan?
That is my plan.
Okay.
So I get a marble and a coin.
My Ferrum.
Which one is that?
That's iron.
Iron. It's a pretty good one. Okay. Well.
Join me for some Ferrum.
Yep.
And then I Arum. Yep. Thanks. Yep. A very thrilling first set of rounds. I'm in a militia. So I'll spend my 4 to outfit both my boat and my guy. And I'm going to do those in a different order. I'm going to put my boat here. All right. I'm gonna marble again. Oops. And I'm gonna script Oh! We've diverged. It's thrilling. A Duellum. Right. Now I'll go ahead and sail down the coast. Ooh, templed already. Ferrum. Get one and one. And now I can afford to settle. And I'll put down a gold settlement here. And I'll go ahead and spend again to place a a marble settlement here. Take the gold action also. So now I get two gold and a coin. Nothing?
Oh, sorry.
Okay. I was pretty sure you were going to do that, unless you were going to do marble first.
To be honest, I'm not making any plans.
Okay.
I'm just letting everybody at home know that I don't particularly care. Just kind of...
Spoiler alert!
Just kind of making things happen, so I'm going to settle a couple cities.
What do you want to put down?
Things that are not... The adjacent. Same as what's next to them. So let's see here. This needs to be either gold or marble. That can be marble.
Okay.
And this one can be
marble or iron.
Also marble. Let's marble it up.
Oh, so you're going for my usual strategy.
Your usual strategy of the only other time I've played this. Yep. Thanks for trying to make those your cities.
I wanted them to be my cities really badly.
Okay.
Okay, so I'm going to go
keep
ahead.
Keep on rocking in the free world.
Yeah, seems like a good choice. I'm going to go ahead and marble. Yeah, I'll get two marble. And a coin. Welcome to the marble party.
Yeah.
Ferrum. You gonna join me for a Ferrum party too?
No.
I'll get one Ferrum. Uh-oh.
Where are you? Science know-how. Pythagoras.
Okay.
All mine. So, I get a wall, and you get to take one of those things.
Yeah. Let's see what I want. I was going to take a look at these before we started filming.
Yeah, so I didn't bother. Decide.
I guess I'll take this one. Oh, I had that one last time. That was cool. Okay, so that's me. I'm going to... I'm gonna go ahead and temple. And then I don't particularly like...
Temples?
No, the fact that we're doing the same thing, kind of.
Get your boats out there. Yeah.
I'm gonna go ahead and do well. So
guide here. And my boat is going to sail this way. And then I'll go ahead and found. City here. I'm gonna spend all my resources.
Does that mean that my boat like just loses immediately?
No, because like... you would have to decide to conquest. You don't have to conquest, so you could choose to not do so. There you go. Persia's coming for you, Greece.
I don't care.
Take my marble action, which gives me 3-4 marble. And a coin. Actually, let's see. If I do that, I won't sail to there. Now I'll go ahead and settle.
We've already messed up.
Oh, I can't do that. What did we do wrong?
We have both made at least 5 cities.
So. Oh, crap. That one's so easy to forget.
I'm going to say you did it first.
Let's see. Yeah, I did. So I'll take one, and then you go to
Leonidas!
Well, that's backwards. For doing that. And then you go up to 2 and you get one of yours. Just so easy to forget about building cities. Okay, so I just settled. So that's you.
I also didn't pay attention to my moneta, so I should have 1 more marble and gold than I actually do.
Okay. That's easy to forget, too, when you first get it. Man. Uh-oh. Okay. Ferrum.
Well,
okay. I'm gonna Aurum, which gives me 2, 3. Oh, and I didn't take a coin for my Ferrum.
Plus one per place you have? Is that what it is?
Per matching thing. Per matching resource that's adjacent.
Yeah. No. No, that's not what I'm asking. Manita is plus one for every place. Now, like, they produce 2 instead of 1. Is that effective?
No, no, no. You gain 1 extra.
More. Okay.
I'll look at that real quick just to make sure, but... Man... Monita would be way, way more powerful. Yeah, it's just plus one unit of the produced type per turn. Man, that would be insanely good. It would double resource production. Oh, why didn't I found a city at the end of my last turn? Not that it matters, but... It's a thing that I could have done. I'm gonna do that. Let's see. 4? Yeah. 4. Got a coin.
Are you finding a city now?
Yeah. I'm gonna find a city now. One back and one means that I can slap down a city there, which appears to have to be a marble city if I don't want to pay extra. Which I guess I'm fine with.
Before you do that, you get a card.
Oh, yeah,
you
get because you have 3 things. That is true. Nothing's going to matter, because it's not going to affect what I built or where, but... yeah, sure. Okay. You. I'll spend 1 to advance further.
That's not the right It's coins, isn't it, not gold?
It's one of any resource. You and I talked about that, remember?
No.
No, we did.
Well, I've been spending my coins.
And I'm going to take marble, so that's 7. And a coin. Yeah, when I was talking about the rules, I pointed out that we had been doing that wrong the first time we played. Ooh, it's thrilling.
Uh-huh.
Man. What an iron, which is still 3.
To change the production of one of my cities.
Nice.
That wasn't
that wasn't even your action. Go.
Yeah. And I'm gonna go and do that. And
yeah.
Get 7.
Whole bunch of iron. I'm gonna temple, which will mean you'll get a card. If I put it there, I have to pay a coin. That's fine. I'll pay a coin. And I'll go ahead and spend my extra marble to build walls there also. Super good one. Oh, that one's cool. That's what I do next. Oh, that is me. Sorry.
No.
Oh, no, it's not?
No.
Yeah, I'm sorry. Okay. Uh-oh. I knew that was going to happen.
So, 6 to put 8 to put all of them out there. Where do you 3, 4 guys want to go?
Gold. Yeah, 5. Well, that's you.
Mm-hmm. with this guy with the boat.
Yeah.
You go conquer Chalcedis. Yes, he's just gonna head this way.
Okay.
This guy can head this way. This guy can head this way. Found a city in Andros. Which gets to be gold.
Okay.
Oh, I can found a city in Delphi, too.
You can.
Gotta cash things in, though. This is now down there. That one I have to pay extra, though.
For anything, yeah.
If I put marble, I have to pay two. If I put gold, you have to pay two. So
iron will cost you one.
Exciting.
Okay.
Yep. Disperse this military unit.
Oh, crap.
Back to the personal supply. And then these guys are all gonna march on the city, burning down the temple.
Yeah.
And I assume the walls, too?
Yeah, I guess. That probably is true. And okay, so the defense there was...
Four.
Four.
So the four guys. So
okay.
They all get removed back to the box. I get a card for destroying a temple. You get to draw one of these cards.
Yeah.
Xerxes is super pumped.
I will...
Are you going to blind us with science?
Yeah, that's actually what I was going to do. Because the next thing I was going to do was buying Republica. Oh, it's 8 for the first person. That's so much.
Pretty expensive.
I'll just spend 4 and also learn about making money. And then I'll spend my other 2 to add dudes into my box. Play my privilege card to advance 6 spaces for free to go to militia. 2, 4, 6, 8, which is the amount of iron that I currently have in my possession. So I'll place 4 units. Place 2 boats. Man. And I guess a man? Yeah. Oh!
I'm doing this wrong. Okay, so this I spent instead of that coin that I now have to pay. Yeah, okay, that works. So, I spend both my coins to build because of the two temples that are adjacent to it.
Okay.
Exciting!
Let's see. Duellum. I can conquer this city. I'll just march that guy, I guess. These three boats. I'll bring them.
You conquered the seven seas.
Yeah, I know. That's what I was looking at.
You have the boat power to do it.
No, I need one more, I think. Yeah, because I could only get to six. Three. But, yeah. That is what I'm looking at doing.
Like, I was locking up Chalcedis so that you can't do it.
Because I'll mess him up.
That's true. Send all your boats over after him.
Think. I'm just gonna. I'll have one guy come to here. One guy to there. Two guys to there.
If you moved him to here, would they wipe each other out instantly?
Yeah, I mean, our units would instantly battle, and
right,
we'd both lose our galley.
I appreciate you
not just wasting our time.
Yeah.
That's how I felt.
Unfortunately, I got bad news for you. It's going to converge on this guy.
All right.
I'm trying to decide if I should just not do that. There's no point.
Like, whatever you want to do. You can indeed wipe out one of my boats.
This guy's going to come down here. I guess those guys are going to wipe each other out.
When they're on the boat space, do they only count as two for navigation, or do they count as two for defense, too?
No, it's just for the...
Just for the navigation?
Yeah.
Okay, that's what I thought.
Disregard. There's no point to my doing that. It doesn't accomplish anything. I was looking at this, like, I can't even found a city in Naxos.
Yeah.
Great. So... I'm gonna get more gold... more gold.
Old temple. I guess I'll build walls. Just restore my once great.
Why don't you have a card for your temple thing? A leader card. Like, we gave you the points for it.
Yeah, we did. I don't know why I didn't take one of the cards. I'll go ahead and found a city. I'll use my settler card to only pay one gold to do so.
But then you have to pay.
But I still have to pay coins for it, for resource purposes, for whatever it's adjacent to.
It's adjacent to two gold, one marble, one.
Yeah. I'll have it be a. I don't really need it to be a marble city. I guess I'll have it be an iron city. And pay one coin for the privilege. Ten, which gives me 10 cities. Is it stupid? That was your, that's a dumb laugh. Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
I don't think that's one of the worst of those.
Yeah. Okay. I'll play my card right away and pay...
One to get rid of one of my...
No, pay one gold and take... Oh. Event card from that. The display. Yeah, I already used that.
Yeah.
Which is win on Marmor each. No! That's not the right one. Disregard. I'm not playing that right now. I'm not playing that right now.
Okay.
It didn't happen. Yeah, I misinterpreted things. That's fine.
That's fine. So you're so doing iron?
I get 8 iron.
Yeah. Let's see. What do I want to do?
I'm going to come down there and settle Halicarnassos. That's what you want to do.
Halicarnassos is a pretty good...
Get those boats going.
It's a pretty good location.
Conquer those seas.
They
are ripe for the conquering.
They are pretty ripe for conquering.
They are at least ripe.
I guess I'm going to... I guess I'm going to stop at
more marble.
Marble on my way to what I want to do. Right? Is that how many I get? Yeah, that's right. Oh, plus one. I don't know if I didn't do that earlier for something. I just took gold, too, didn't I? I didn't do that for my
money. I don't know. I'm not paying attention to what you're doing.
It's okay. I think I'm square now. I think I just...
Did you rebuild the temple and walls at Larissa?
Yes.
People are determined.
They are. They are pros at building town walls.
No, I don't... I have no plans anymore. I don't care. I'm just doing things... I don't even know why I'm grabbing a coin. I'm building a temple. It's going to cost me coins to do it.
Yeah.
I don't even have an interest in where I put it. It's going to be cheaper in Olympia or Pylos. So I guess we'll put it in Olympia. And that's going to cost a coin to do it. And... Okay, I guess that's it.
Okay.
I built a temple.
Yeah, I'm gonna go ahead and be bold.
Great.
Spend 11 gold.
To do what?
Learn all about moving.
Okay.
Which means I get 2 scholars.
You get a wall. Get a wall?
Yeah.
And I get 2 cards.
Yep.
Which means I take one of these that I don't really want.
Yeah, and then you'll get whatever this one is. I'll get
this one, and then probably whatever this is.
Yeah.
Yes, that's fine.
It's new. Okay. Pay 2 gold to get 2 marble and 2 iron.
Okay.
That's you.
Is it? I've lost track.
Yeah, because I just spent all the money doing research.
Well, that's nice, I guess. I don't know what to say.
Yeah, I don't know.
I'm gonna get... ...7 gold. I have it.
Yeah.
It's here.
I guess I'm gonna Duellum now with all my special movement powers.
Yeah, move those boats all over the place.
Yeah. I'm just gonna... Yeah, I don't even know what to do with all my ability to move now. I guess I'm just gonna march right down into the heart of your territory and conquer that. And then...
Okay.
Hmm?
No, it's fine.
I guess I'll...
So close to being in charge of the Seven Seas.
That's going to be the next goal.
And you better build a boat.
Yep. I have to build boats.
That's you. Is that it?
Yeah.
Okay.
I just moved all my stuff.
I don't... I don't know what I'm doing anymore.
I just conquered one of your cities, so you get a card.
That's true, but you should also get a card from when I conquered Larissa a long time ago. Yeah. And we didn't do it.
Yeah. I just realized
that... So we could either just not do it for the purposes of this game, or you could draw one of these cards first and then take another
card. Reconquered Larissa from you, so actually you get 2 cards.
Do you want to draw one of those 3 cards, even though those were not what were out there now?
It's fine.
Like, I am not using the 3 cards I have.
Yeah, so... neither am I. I don't think the cards are that big of a deal. So you're probably going to take that, whatever it is, because it's better than whatever's there. And then you'll probably take that, because it's better than whatever's there.
Yeah. Okay. Well, maybe this will give me all the things that I want to do.
Yeah. I just suddenly realized that that was a rule that we hadn't been following. Because I just think of cards as a thing that only happens when you get points, and you get points for conquering cities. Unless you burn down some temple action.
Well, you did bring it up. Have that much iron just hanging around, so let's bring these guys out. Oh, back to Oreos.
Yep. Goodbye,
Delphi.
Delphi. I'm gonna Ferrum. Strip mine Delphi while
I have the forge that you just gave me, so one of my militia actions were free of cost, so I got 2 iron back that I didn't.
Oh, weird. Okay. Yep. Sounds good. Oh, and I get 1 for Monita, and I get a coin.
When on Marmor, each own marble city produces one marble extra. That's going to be...
It's a really good one.
3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8,
yeah.
9.
Yep.
9 marble.
And a coin.
And a coin.
Yeah, last time when we played, I was really bummed that that card came out... like, right after I'd finished with my marble engine, where I was producing, like, you know, 12 marble a turn. No, I don't think so. I think I'm gonna go to Aurum. 2, 5, so 6. And a coin.
I'm gonna spend 19 gold.
Wow.
To learn the remaining two sciences, you're gonna get two cards.
Okay.
And also strata. So.
Okay.
That moves me up to here. I get a wall. And the remaining two of these guys.
Three, four, five, six personages.
Yeah.
Okay. The courage is terrible.
It's pretty bad. The late game, it's not... I'm not sure it's helpful in the early game. In fact, it's bad in all circumstances.
I talked about that in my written review of how I think the cards are kind of garbage. Like, this could be situationally helpful. I guess this is the most useful of the things, which is pretty bad. Oh, okay. Oh, man, I'm boned. Okay. Oh, no. Oh, no. What do I do? I'm Militia.
Send those guys out.
I am. I'm going to send those guys out in a doomed defense.
Why? Okay. Well, alright.
There you go.
Great.
I'm going to go ahead and gang... Which lets me build walls when I'm not on...
Templum. Where?
I'll build a wall.
In Delphi.
Delphi?
Great.
Just to waste your time.
Okay.
And here in Pila to waste your time some, too.
Build a temple.
Okay.
Which costs me 6 plus... Ooh, I might not even be physically capable of doing it, because you have to pay one coin.
One coin for each adjacent temple. So it starts getting really expensive.
Okay, I'm not even physically capable of doing it. I guess I can duel him.
That's true.
Move him here and him here. These guys want to come, like, have a duel they can. Or not? Like, what? No, that's fine. I don't care. Like, that's okay. Or, like, I guess I could move these two guys up here and conquer Pila.
Yeah.
That would accomplish nothing except give you one of those trash cards.
Yeah.
I guess I'm gonna found at least a city.
Okay.
Marble
city for free.
What?
A marble city for free.
Says who?
Or I mean, a marble city without paying coins.
Oh, okay.
Since it's like, the only thing
I don't have a card that says that. Yeah. So
I just meant a city that you don't have to pay extra for.
Mm-hmm.
I think what I need to do is I need to play the stupid merchant card.
Trade resources with me.
To give you 3 marble.
Okay.
And I'm going to get gold.
3 gold?
I think so. Yeah, go ahead and just give me 3 gold.
There's 3 for you. Change.
And then I can spend this 2, 2, and 2 to build 2 cities, and we'll see what else happens at that point. Alright, so that's going to cost something extra no matter what. Oh no, it gets no, to be
if it's marble, it doesn't cost you extra.
Okay, so that's marble. This one can be anything other than gold. That can be, that has to cost something.
That one can't be iron if you don't want it to cost extra. Well, so that can only be
we are too. Rocking the marble then. Yeah. I have 9 cities. So if I want to build in Lemnos, I have to spend another 1 of each. But then I can't afford to do the extra cost, so I can't do anything else about that.
Okay.
Alright.
Okay. That actually really ruined my plans for this turn.
I'm so sorry.
But...
I'm sorry that I incidentally ruined your plans.
It's okay, because I can play my Academy card... to get 4 gold for going to science, because you've researched 4 things. Which gives me my money back that I needed.
Are you going to learn how to... Res Publica? Commercium? Oh, I forgot I had Commercium. I probably could have traded things. Yeah, I actually could have traded things and built
Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah. Go ahead and trade marble at a cost of 3 for 2.
So this would actually be...
So you get 2 marble back, and then you can turn that into 2 iron, or an iron and a gold, or whatever you want. Iron.
And then
you spent a gold, an iron, and a marble. And then you can found either a gold city or an iron city for a cost of 1 coin.
Mm-hmm. So now I have 10 cities, so you get a card.
Okay.
Let's see if Enjoy them.
Yeah, they're all bad. I'm spending... I spent a whole bunch of gold to get Res Publica to increase...
It's fine.
It's actually just Republica, isn't it?
I don't know. It was Res Publica.
Okay, so it is Res Publica. Okay.
It's coming out.
When arming a militia, 1 is free of cost because of your shipyard.
Oh, 1 galley is free of cost.
Yeah. When you have militia.
So good.
Okay. Okay, so I did that, and I'm putting 2 boats into my thing.
Boats?
Yeah. Indeed. Boats, boats, boats.
Gold, I guess? Each of my gold saves is going to produce 1 gold extra.
Oh, man.
So I'm getting 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11 gold.
Wow.
Coin.
Man, you're getting, like, all of the good cards. For things like that. Yeah, I'm gonna have to go to iron. Which is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Yeah, 5 iron plus 1 for money plus 1 coin. Okay, it's you. Oh,
Just... Great. Yeah. It's good.
Appreciate it.
I guess, like, those guys go up and destroy Pila, and then you could take Ambrachia. Like, it doesn't accomplish anything except give you a card. These two guys... What would happen if these guys walked in? Do they eliminate each other, or is it like...
They eliminate each other.
So they fight outside of the city.
I'll read it to you.
Okay.
Like, it's...
Conveniently vague.
Well, the first thing that happens is movement. So, you move all of your things, the order in which they move is freely chosen, blah blah blah. Moving. If military units enter or want to cross a region where there are already hostile units of the same type, a battle automatically occurs. In this case, both opponents loose the same number of units of the same type. They cancel each other out at a one-to-one basis and are placed back in their respective things. So, yes. If you enter there, I can't even choose to, like, have my dudes stay in a city.
Well, then these two dudes are gonna cancel out these two dudes.
Okay. So. It is one of the things that infuriates me.
And... For... Like... There's no... I guess... I can come stand over back in Oreos.
Okay.
Yeah.
Any more gold? Two. Five.
So, I pay one gold and take one event card from the open display.
Okay.
Which is this one. So, a new card comes out. Great. Would have been nice. For each own scholar, collect one resource of your choice.
Yeah.
So, I've got three scholars, so yep. I get...
Three resources.
Three resources. Which... I'll take this is just gonna waste our time because I'm gonna take three iron, I'm gonna take the arming action and put my two guys back out on the board.
Okay. Okay.
There we go.
I go to militia.
You put your guys back on the board.
That was 5, 6, 7, 8. Yeah, so that's four boats. Place one here and three here. And then I'll also go ahead and place one of my dudes. Yeah, that's all I can do.
So, these guys come and destroy the temple. And
I increase the defense of the city by one when you do so, so all of those dudes just died.
Okay, thanks for wasting our time.
You're welcome.
Great. There we go.
Yep. I dwell them. Let's see. Don't go to stupid places, Rob. Go 1, 2, 3, 4. Hey, I'm sailing the seven seas. 7 points. 7 points. to get a point. Yeah. That's it.
Okay.
I moved. Oh, I should have done that last time. That was dumb of me. Oh well. Yeah. Okay, I'm going to maybe be stupid. Go to Duellum on this side and collapse these guys to burn down that temple. You have raised Pulcadia, so 4. And I guess I'll bring that other boat up. So that it's here. I guess I'll just have sailed it over to here. I'll purchase. So I get 3 back, and then I get 2 iron and 2 marble. And yeah, I guess go ahead and found city there, which can produce anything because there's nothing there. So I guess it'll be Iron City, which gives me 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9.
What are you counting? You have 13 cities.
12, 13. Okay, yeah. That's what I was counting. Okay.
Okay, so these guys are all coming back out.
Okay.
Have a good old time.
Yep.
Yep, we're gonna just enjoy this. Cause so much fun.
Yep. Can do is go to 3. Yeah. I'll go there and put some dudes in my box.
As well.
Yeah, oh shit, that was what you were doing.
This cancels out your Res Publica because it reduces your defense by 1. So, you can just I'll go in there and wipe it out.
Okay. those temple destruction cards.
They're great. They're good. You can get one of your galleys out there for free.
Yeah, now that I'm done with galleys.
Yep. What is it? You get a coin for every fewer guy you have than me, yes. So one?
Yeah. Right.
I'm not sure why you're missing a card, whatever it should be, because you've only got
six. Oh, I didn't take a temple destruction one when I burned your temple down. That's what happened.
Whatever.
Okay.
What'd you take?
I took the free galley. Okay, so I get 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 iron and a coin. Choo.
Like, whatever. I don't really...
By spending a coin, spend 8, and I'll use my shipyard card. So it's gonna be a free ship. Yeah, okay. So I get one ship for free, and then I paid for 4 extra units. So I'm gonna place one here.
Really doesn't matter, does it? Okay. Well, whatever.
Okay. I duel him. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 destroys everything that's there. Also move this ship that I forgot I had. I guess I'll move it this way since that's cheaper. That's not you.
Wow. Yeah. Okay, sorry. I've been looking at actions that have not been
been even remotely applicable. Yeah, I know how that goes. I've done that a couple of times. I use diplomacy to use your iron city instead of one of mine and gain 10 iron. I then prosperity, which gives me 2 gold because I have two cities with walls. I then found a city. Which just can't be a marble city. It was actually 11 iron. I forgot my Monita. And I'll found it as a gold city. Why not? You can place two units there. I dwell them. I found another city. That's it.
Yeah.
There you go. That sigh says it all, people. It's Antike Duellum, which is a duellum in the Antike.
Right. So this designer, I would say, likes to make games that have a historical theme.
Okay.
And from what I've seen, it seems like he takes the time to actually do the research to try and capture the feeling of being one or the other, you know, opposing force.
Okay, sure.
I think this is only, like, specifically two-player game. So in other circumstances, like, multiple forces involved in conflicts and whatnot. So I appreciate that someone is taking the time to ground their game in that thematic element like that. I think it's really easy to just make a game about two sides or having a war and that's it. Yeah. But instead, it does seem like some amount of care was taken into trying to set up, and I don't know anything about this subject material, so I could be incredibly wrong, but it seems to me that it looks like, you know, okay, these are where these cities are, and they have strategic value to these specific cities, and this is how you would want to set up a force doing various things. And I appreciate someone taking the time to do that. And that goes further in that the game comes with this historical background.
Yeah.
Which is eight pages? An 8-page long history about
the Persian Wars and the Punic Wars.
So You've got that in case you are curious about learning what this game is supposed to be talking to you about. I think I really appreciate this. I don't even care about the things that it's talking about because I don't care about most old historic things. But I do appreciate this, and I do wish more games had things like this. I don't think that the cost of production increases dramatically by including a little booklet like this that talks about things like that. It doesn't even need to be 8 pages, but
that somebody's done the research and is trying to explain to you, like, this is why this game is about what it's about, and this is what the theme is and how it works and fits together.
Because too often the reverse happens, that someone makes a game and then they say it needs a theme and they put something
that
there
will slap onto the mechanics.
This is clearly done from the opposite perspective. This is someone taking the care into looking at a topic that seemed interesting to them and trying to wrap a game around it.
Mm-hmm.
And I appreciate that.
Okay. How do you think it does at that?
That being said, I don't think this is
a fun game. I think it has a specific audience, and I'm not yet.
Okay.
For me, I felt like in both plays of the game that it was very dry,
mm-hmm.
very repetitive,
mm-hmm.
and just boring in general. I understand that, like, a lot of times old historic games do come off as dry, and I don't really know what you can do for someone who doesn't necessarily care about that theme to make it more exciting.
Mm-hmm.
But for me, I don't...
Mm-hmm.
I'm not interested in what's happening, really. And it goes further in that the mechanics of the game being based on the Rondel, I cannot think of another game off the top of my head where I have felt like I am just doing the same things over and over again to the extreme that I felt like with this game,
mm-hmm.
where it's just gather one or the other resource that you need so that you can take the action with that resource and repeat that.
Yeah.
And that's the whole game.
Yeah.
And just, you know, I understand, like, that you have to kind of strategically figure out what your best move is as you're going around. Like, okay, well, now I've got these three options in front of me. Or I've got more options if I want to spend resources and be less efficient.
Yeah.
I don't know if, like, the key to that is you're supposed to kind of just ignore the limitation of the three and don't worry about efficiency, because so often it feels like you want to do a thing that's immediately behind you,
mm-hmm.
and it's just through a matter of placement of, like, you can only recruit militia in one location. You can only send people out on the board from one spot on the action board, and if you wanted to do that immediately after gathering, you know, immediately after taking the science action to put them on the board so you can send them out,
mm-hmm.
you need to spend a bunch of resources to get back around the circle.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I know what you mean.
And to me, that's the problem, is that that makes no real sense to me thematically, that it's that difficult to
accomplish. Muster troops, equip them, and then move them?
Yeah.
Yeah.
I just feel like the sequence doesn't make any sense to me. And I also just kind of, like, I don't feel like there's anything really, like, you look at that wheel and, like, the actions you have, three of them are all the same thing, just getting a resource.
Mm-hmm.
Two of them are the same thing in just moving people.
Yep.
And then you've got research and put people on the board and build a temple.
Yeah.
Or walls.
Mm-hmm.
And it just doesn't... I'm not convinced that this, having it force you to do that system of moving in a circle, is better than just giving you the ability to do those actions when you want to do them.
Yeah.
I understand it's kind of more like a puzzle, because it's like, okay, well, now you have to figure out how to deal with it this way. But for me, it's just like, well, I want to do this thing now, but I can't because now I don't have the resources. So it becomes a game about just, like, planning five turns in the future.
Mm.
And that's not engaging to me.
It's Quartermaster the board game.
Yeah,
I agree. I don't think that this game is very exciting or interesting. It's... I think that the biggest problem is definitely the Rondel, which, for exactly the reasons that you talked about, that it's very repetitive, it's very much, okay, I move and get this resource, and now I can either spend a resource to get to the place I want, or I can pick up another resource. I guess I'll pick up more resources, and bouncing back and forth trying to move through actions in a way that lets you do things is something that takes a lot of forethought and is not really exciting as a game mechanic to me either. I think the other thing that makes it feel really dry and kind of boring is the way that combat is just one-to-one elimination. So, you know, there's no quantity, and I want to be clear that I don't like strategy combat games that are like Risk, where it's just purely about dice rolling.
But there's something about Risk where like someone could rout a bigger opponent. Yeah, exactly. There's a chance that it could happen because that happens historically.
Yeah.
And that's not here.
Yeah, and I think that's the big thing that kills this game for me, that for both players, you just sit there and you can very easily count, like, okay, he has, you know, 5 attack strength, my city has 4 defense strength, I need to generate 2 troops at that city to defend it, okay, I'm good. And then, unless there's a card that can come into play, and you know what both players' cards are, so if, you know, you're aware of what's going on there, you can plan ahead for that.
You know, I actually wanted to, is it clear in the rules whether or not you're supposed to know who's, what cards people have? Are you supposed to have a hand of cards after you take them?
Well, I guess I'm not sure either. It could be that you're supposed to, that it's
we just kept it out on the table.
Yeah, we played it as open information because that was the sense I got, but I suppose it's possible that it's not supposed to be.
And that's why some people say it's a hand management game.
Oh, maybe. You know, I think that the early game is very much about resource management and production, because you don't have the resources to be fielding armies yet. So it's very much about building settlements and expanding your influence until you come into contact with each other. And then conflict, as you now have the resources to build troops. And I just don't find that part of the game interesting. Like, the early game isn't bad to me of moving around and dropping settlements and figuring out what resources you want so that you'll be able to build whatever your engine is. If you're trying to, you know, make money to do sciencey stuff or build temples so that your cities are more efficient, or doing iron so that you have defenses ready. I find that part of the game pretty interesting. The combat part, not interesting at all, because there's no little random elements to it. And I think that's kind of a necessity in a strategy game, that there has to be some quantity of
chance,
unsurety, at the very least. You know, whether that's through dice rolling or, you know, players having some kind of a card mechanic so that you play something that, you know, boosts the strength of your forces, or however that's going to work, or random events happening, you know, something, I think, has to be involved that makes you consider how many troops you're committing to something, and if that's, you know, reasonably sure of victory, because there's never guaranteed victory in strategy games, in good strategy games for me. And I think that's the big problem here for me.
In historical
real life. Yeah, like, in real life, too.
Wars are determined by, like, oh, the weather changed at a random moment,
yeah,
and, you know,
yeah,
your people starved and you couldn't fight. You,
yeah,
know, it's just,
or it rained and now your cavalry's useless because of the way the terrain is laid out, or, you know, whatever. There has to be something that's like that in a game for it to work for me, and this not having it is what kills it.
So, unfortunately, neither of us have played Antike, which is the first game,
okay,
and then this is the two-player specific version of it that changes were made to make it a two-player game,
because
mm-hmm, it was not viable as a two-player game, which is not shocking. That's real common with,
yeah,
any kind
with
of
strategy kind of games, yeah.
And now there's Antike 2, which is a revision of Antike after Antike Duellum. So this is sort of the middle of that process.
Okay.
I wouldn't think it would be too much of a stretch to say this is not as refined as Antike 2.
Probably true, yeah.
But because neither of us have played Antike or the other, we can't really compare them.
Sure.
The odds are very good that if you only have two people and you want to play Antike, then this is probably what you need to do, because you can't play the other one for it wouldn't be fun or good. The big difference that I remember reading about is that putting units out on the board is not a two-step process. It's you just
pay, purchase the units,
and they're there. Yeah. You don't have a box that you have to put them in the box, yeah, and then get them out there.
I think that's the most one of the most frustrating things about this game, that you have to hit gold, and then it's four spaces to put the troops in your box, so you have to either take another action or spend resources to get there.
And then six more spaces to get them out on the board.
Well,
two spaces go to get iron.
Then you go get iron so that you put them on the board. And then it's four spaces to put them on the board. So in every situation there, you're either having to take one wasted action or
decide, I'm going to put forces on the board, but I need to be doing other things in the meantime, yeah, as yeah, well.
Slowing down your attempts to do that. And then that's not even moving troops if you already have troops on the board.
Mm-hmm. So anyway, you know, like, that's the reason, as far as I can tell, why you have a box, is because in a two-player game, if it weren't there, then it would just be a winning strategy to just
drop
forces at the start of the game and sweep over the other guy.
Yeah.
So that might be the biggest thing is, while I don't really feel like mechanically this is a game that interests me anyway, I really don't like it because it is specifically a two-player game. And it seems like it's a game that encourages you to do different things to get a path to victory.
Mm-hmm.
There's science, and you get victory points if you're the first to get out to science, and that's great.
But you can't get enough victory points.
That's right. You cannot win strictly from science.
You can't win strictly through combat, because there's only three temple cards.
You can't win strictly through exploration.
Yeah.
Which is exploration, I mean, like, you know, exploration in terms of explore the seas for whatever reason, that's a victory condition, just have boats in the water.
Yeah.
And then building cities everywhere, so sort of an exploration colonization victory achievement. You can't win through any individual thing, you have to combine things, and that's fine, that doesn't really bother me too much, but
I'm not sure that you can realistically win with only two of them, even. I think you have to do at least three things.
Well, I think you're forced to do three things because you can't focus on a strategy because of the rondelle.
Yeah.
And you're like, well, I want to build up forces, but I can't do it in any kind of reasonable fashion. So in the meantime, I need to get gold so I can research things.
So that I can make resources more efficiently or build temples so that my cities are more efficient. Yeah.
And you were talking about this idea of how you like, you're interested by the early game, which is, you know, building up the ability to manufacture resources and, you know, building temples and stuff like that, and colonization.
Mm.
And it kind of reminded me of, like, playing, like, Civilization on the computer, not the board game.
Yeah.
And how it's like, you start out and you got nothing.
Yeah.
And you settle, you have one capital, and then you make colonists, settlers to go out and make more cities, explore the map. And then you run into people as you go along, and you're like, okay, well, now I have to deal with sort of the political aspect of things.
And building up an army.
Suddenly, you know, if you're playing against a computer, like, eventually someone will just start a war with you because they felt like it.
Yeah.
And then you suddenly have to deal with war and all that. It always seems like, you know, as civilization goes along, eventually people get into fights and you have to deal with it. But in that game, you can win by focusing on just science. You can kind of like shore up your defenses a little bit, or you could make, you know, sort of deals with other factions to come and kind of protect you, kind of a thing. But it seems like that's the kind of thing I expect this to try to be, that, like, if it gives you the ability to, you could do science if you want to do science, or you could colonize if you want to colonize, or you want to build temples, that's fine. Or you could fight people. Mm. But it doesn't let you focus on what you want to do. It makes you diversify in a way that kind of annoys me more okay. than anything sure. else.
You almost brushed up against it, so I'm going to ask you what you think of the cards. We kind of talked about it during the game.
So, most of the cards don't seem very good. Some of them are situationally helpful. They can come out in a pinch.
There are a couple that are just, like, outstandingly good, but overall, yeah, it's, like, shocking how bad some of them are.
There were no cards in the original Antike, so it's, you know, like a, well, I'm going to add this in to give you something else to, you know, it's a catch-up mechanic, but, like, if you're catch-up, like, we're sitting there, and I'm like, there were times during our game where I was just, like, trying to get you to
take a card so there was something else out there. Yeah.
And, like, you can just wipe out a city. I don't care.
Yeah.
And it's just, I don't know. the only other game I've played by this designer is Concordia, which blows this out of the water for a lot of reasons. But it is a combination of having a map with things to deal with, and the cards are more of a deck building thing instead of just cards you play arbitrarily.
Mm-hmm.
Because in order to take actions, you play cards out of your hand kind of thing instead of dealing with that nonsense.
Yeah.
And I think it works so much better. Concordia came out the year after this, so I think it's fair to look at it in the light of, well, what if I took an existing thing and added cards? Okay, it kind of works. Let's see what I can do to make it better. And I think this is sort of a stepping stone to get to that point.
Mm-hmm.
The game comes with a double-sided board, which is
kind of cool.
Nice, but there's like an argument that it's not balanced. But I don't really want to play the game enough to figure that out.
Mm-hmm.
Statistically. The problem with that it's a double-sided board is that here we have one side
for the Persian Wars,
and here we have the other side
for the Punic Wars.
And when I set it up, you legitimately did not know that I'd set up the other side of the board. Like, you looked at it and just didn't understand it was a completely different geographic area.
I wasn't, like, paying that much attention, but yeah, I just kind of glanced down and I was like, oh, did you flip the board over?
Oh, we're doing the same side again?
And
no,
then,
no, we're not.
And then I looked at it more closely and I was like, oh, that's the Aegean. What am I talking about? Yeah, I think it's just that the board is just so bland and, like, there are no features. It's just, you know, water and then islands, and it's kind of arbitrarily broken up into regions, and, you know, none of that is especially attractive or meaningful.
So, I mean, it's, again, a thing that's nice that they took the time to make a double-sided board, because I know that would take extra playtesting time, and I appreciate the effort that goes into that.
Mm-hmm.
But it does feel like it's almost arbitrary which side of the board you play on. It doesn't feel like...
Yeah, I don't feel like it makes any difference which side you're on.
It felt the same to me, but,
yeah,
you know,
I don't think that there's any real significant difference between the two.
Another thing that this has that Antike didn't have is a modular board where you decide what cities are as you put them on the board.
Okay.
In Antike, they were presets. This is what this produces. So this has that element of you have to pay for cities that are the same thing next to other cities, even if it's your opponent's cities. And that doesn't really make sense thematically to me. Like, this idea of, like, you can't produce marble because the city next to you produces marble.
Mm-hmm.
You have to pay for that privilege to specialize in marble. But, like, geographically,
if there was marble, there's probably marble in the adjacent region.
And that's what they would
yeah.
focus on.
I think that You know, it's just a mechanic to prevent you from building all the iron cities and just producing, you know, a million iron every turn. That my guess is that in playtesting, they found that that was a problem somewhere. So they decided that they needed to restrict you in some way by penalizing producing the same thing over and over.
Well, in the end, that's how I feel about this game, is it feels like it's just restricting and doesn't let you do what you want to do, really. There's also this variant, which is
kind of bewildering.
You've got white superboats and brown generalmans. And you can't choose which one you get.
Yeah, yeah. It's
whatever just, color you happen to be.
If you're brown, you get the commander. If you're white, you get the boats. And they're double-sided, but they just have the same...
Like, there's not a white general and not a brown boat.
Yeah, I think that's odd.
And
which color you are is just which side of the board you're sitting on. So it's not like...
Unless you're like, man, I gotta play the Greeks!
Yeah.
And then you're like, oh, congratulations, you get a man. Wait, which one is the Greeks?
Well, like, the way that I think it's intended is that brown is the Greeks, or brown is Carthage, and then white is the Persians or Rome. But I don't know that that's even true, because, I mean, you could set up settlements in whatever order you wanted, so... You know, it just seems like these settlements are next to this box, so brown is intended to be Greece to me.
Hmm. So, yeah... This variant exists. I don't know why.
Yeah, I don't think that it's especially interesting. They cost 3 iron instead of 2 to put out, and they just don't seem like they're that good. And, I mean, maybe there's somebody who's watching this that's, like, really into Antike Duellum and is yelling at me right now and is like, no, the commander is so good! All the difference!
Well, it doesn't exist in either of the other versions of Antike, so I don't think that's likely to be true. I think it's just... Honestly, I imagine they had just had extra punch board space. They're like, here you go! Yeah. Here's a variant!
Yeah.
Yeah,
I don't know. I think it's a weird variant in that it's not great.
So, yeah, there you go.
How would you rate Antike Duellum?
Something like a 4, maybe 4.5. Like, I don't... I like I said, I think the game has a lot of merits in its setup, but it, like, the design approach to it. But ultimately, if I don't enjoy the game, and at no point did I enjoy playing this in either of the two plays we put down, if it's not enjoyable, then I can't really recommend it to anyone. So, there are games that I think are much simpler that I've given 5s to that I'd rather play than this.
Sure.
So I can't really give it a very high rating.
Okay. So. I think I gave this either like a 4.5 or a 5 in my written review. I think that, you know, mechanically, I think, like, it's not bad mechanically. It's just not interesting to me. I know people who would probably like this game and would think it was great, but I'm not into this type of a game, so I can't give it a higher rating than that.
Well, there you go.
Yep.
That's the Antique Duellum.
That is. It is Antique Duellum. And obviously neither of us is too thrilled about it, so there you go.